Hello everyone, this is Amir from Audio Science Review. We're back to reviewing a controversial product, premium speaker cable. It's from a company called Morrow SP3. Well, the model number is SP3, company's name is Morrow Audio. And the version I have is this cable, as you can see also in the review. It's an 8-foot cable. It's in the bi-wire configuration, so you've got one pair at the amplifier end, and then you can split it and drive the tweeter and the woofer with two separate wires. The cable itself is actually quite flexible. I don't know what's inside this woven jacket, but whatever it is, it's much more flexible than typical high-end speaker cables. They tend to be stiff like these are. But what's in here is soft, and from that point of view, it also doesn't weigh a ton on that, which I appreciate. It seems like a lot of the high-end companies want to sell by weight and dimensions, and they make these garden hose speaker cables, hoping that the customers are swayed by that. As premium cables go, this is actually quite reasonable in price. It's $149 for the base cable, and then you can specify what connectors and whether you want to buy wire or not. If you add all that up, it's $187, but they seem to have a sale of 38% right now, which gets it back down to $145 or so. So in grand scheme of things, this is not expensive. If you were to sit at home and make cables for somebody for $150, there's a lot of work involved in mucking with this thing. So I think it's a very tedious job, and you'd be lucky to make a lot more than minimum wage. So they must make their money from their cables from higher up in the line. At any rate, I like the quality of the connectors at the end. They made it quite well and tight without being exceedingly stiff into both my measurement system and also real amplifier and speakers that I connected it to. Excuse me. Typical of cable company marketing material, if you look up what they say is the proprietary technology, it says it removes major distortion that's common in most other cable designs. Of course, they never show any measurements of their cable or any other one, so it's up to us now to go and evaluate that. So the easiest way for me to test the cable and nothing but the cable is to hook it up directly to my audio precision analyzer. My audio precision analyzer has a set of banana jacks that are used for differential measurements. So you could just hook them up and then use whatever wire you want. And so it made it quite nicely to these cables. It has it both for input and output. The drawback is that the output impedance is 40 ohms and the input speed impedance by default is 200 kilo ohms. Typical amplifier has an output impedance well under 1 ohm, and your speakers are, you know, could be anywhere from 4 ohm to 40, 50 ohms. So from that point of view, it is not a one-to-one replication of how a speaker cable would be used. In a sense, I'm testing the speaker cable as if it's an interconnect, which is a more stringent test because now noise and things like that can get into the cable, and it's at 8-foot length with no shielding. It could potentially upset the measurements. So there's some pros and cons in this testing, but I'll address this when we get closer to the end. So I went ahead and connected the input to output. My audio precision analyzer is quite capable, so I can dial up the output to 20 volts, so simulating an amplifier producing probably around 50 watts or so into 8 ohms. And when I do that, it's basically there's nothing there to see in that the sine add is 122 dB, which is world class for DACs. Amplifiers can't even get this close, and this basically what it's doing is showing the as good as the analyzer itself can measure itself. So the wire, when I can bypass it in analyzer where an internal short occurs with a relay, the two were the same. So this wire had same performance for good or bad. That was, you know, the same as what the little internal connection is into the analyzer. You see two channels in here, by the way, because I went from one input to two, one output to two inputs because it's bi-wire and we're measuring both And we see that it makes no difference that the outputs are separated as it should be on this thing. Now the key is how well you know, this cable does compare to you know, generic cable. And for generic cable, excuse me, let me dig it up in here. I forgot to find it before the review, and it has here we go. I was going to say it has disappeared on me, but I found it. I grabbed some really old zip cord speaker cable I have. This is probably 30 to 40 year old cable. I don't throw away stuff like this as long as it's not rotting. And I reached in my attic and I found this cable, and it wasn't terminated, and I've run out of banana plugs, and just grab whatever I could. A couple of these really semi nasty banana ones, Chinese ones from Amazon, and a couple of better quality ones on this thing. So they're just terminated, not even the same at each end, and the wire is roughly the same length as the other one, about 8 foot or so. You can see it's kind of gnarly and stiff, and it's thin gauge. Is quite stiff compared to the other cable. And so let's see how bad this one is compared to our premium cable that we just tested. This is probably, by the way, $5 worth of material, if that. We see that now there's only one channel here because I'm just going from one input to one output. I ran this at slightly different times, so the exact numbers are a little bit different. Analyzer is not perfect, and depending on time and temperature, it varies just a bit. But we can see the sine at is 121.6 dB, and it was 121.6 dB before. The distortion is minus 150 decibels, and before was maybe 145 with the other cable. But again, these are just run-to-run variations. It shows that the crusty old 30, 40-year-old cable is able to pass through this 20-volt signal with just vanishingly small distortion noise. Our threshold of hearing for anything, any tone, any sound is about 115, minus 115 here. And we can see that we were able to, with both of these cables, far exceed threshold of hearing for a human. Next thing I did was that I ran a frequency response test, and not just an ordinary frequency response that stops at 20 kilohertz, but I've actually gone to 200 kilohertz. Again, my audio precision analyzer is quite capable and is able to measure way past the audible band. So you can see this thing, it just looks very, very flat. There's a little bit of wiggle in it, but look at the scale. The scale vertically is only 1 dB up, 1 dB down. Typically, when I run a frequency response test, this is minus 5, and on the other side is plus 5. I've zoomed way in 10 to 1, and you still can't see any variation to 200 kilohertz between this SP3, Morrow Audio SP3 cable and my generic crusty $5 cable. And but again, this is, you know, treating it as like an interconnect, and there may be some effects when the impedances change. But here, by the way, we're sweeping at all frequencies from 10 hertz all the way up to 200 kilohertz, so it's not one tone. And we're measuring all frequencies, we're measuring ultrasonic frequencies. What this tells us is that the tonality can't change, because tonality is determined by frequency response, and that's not changing. So somebody says it's louder, or I hear more bass and more mids or whatever, that's just not true. Yeah, the level hasn't changed and the tonality has not changed. Back to people making excuses for these things. They say, well, a sine wave is, you know, this simple thing. They think it's a static signal, but it's actually not a static signal. A sine wave goes up and down from minus, you know, 27 volts peak to peak or so, whatever that comes out to be. And it's certainly not one number and one voltage. So we actually run it through a full set of voltages. So there's nothing static about a sine wave on that. But hey, we can make more complex waveforms. And here I've taken our standard multi-tone test, which is 32 tones, all with different phases. combined. And if you look at that in the time domain, as I've shown in other videos, is quite random and complex. You would think it's music. Indeed, if you play this, it sounds like an organ playing. It feels like, sounds like many of the notes, you know, your organ where you put your hand down on many keys at once, and that's what it sounds like. So in a way, it's music-like. It's certainly a lot more complex from compared to music because its tones in high frequency have full amplitude, whereas typical music, this would drop like a rock over here. So we're stressing the cable and the systems a lot more. I went ahead and tested the generic cable, the Morrow SP3, and the analyzer itself. In all three cases, the distortion and noise are identical. They all land on top of each other, and the colors actually mix in. You can't see it. Our distortion is down at 21 to 22 bits. It's about a minus 120, minus 125 to minus 130. Remember, our threshold of hearing is minus 115. So we're at 15 to 20 dB better than that as far as distortion. So whatever distortion the generic cable is creating, which the company said was a problem, is below the distortion floor of the audio precision analyzer, which in turn is 20, 30 dB better than our hearing. And that's basically 100 to 1,000 times better than our hearing. So the analyzer is quite sensitive in that matter on this thing. And we can also run a distortion plus noise sweep where we vary the frequency and see if we have any distortion and noise. And when I do that, again, we see that there's just no difference. Both cables just land on top of each other, and there's just no way to distinguish them from each other. They're just extremely clean, minus 115, minus 116. This is testing harmonic structure all the way up to 90 kilohertz, so 4.5 times the audible band to compute the harmonic structure of 20 kilohertz. And again, just not a hair out of place. It just, there's no difference there. But I knew if I just stopped here, people will say, well, this doesn't look like an amplifier test and a speaker test because there's no speaker involved and there's no amplifier involved and impedances are different. So I figured I'd do a more clever test in that I took this Purify amplifier that I have, this state-of-the-art amplifier, and use that to amplify the output of my audio precision analyzer, and that gets connected to a clip speaker that you can't see that's behind me. I put the clip speaker on a desk so that it's not too loud, although it has a port in the back, so it was still whistling pretty loud from the back. So I covered the port also because we don't care about what the speaker is producing. We want to measure the effect of a cable. And so if I did nothing, this would just pump out test tones into the amplifier, and the amplifier produces sends a signal to a speaker, and the tones would play. But instead of just measuring that, I went ahead and hooked up channel 1 and channel 2 of my analyzer in a special way, in that the channel 1 is measuring what signal we have at the beginning of the speaker cable, and the channel 2 is measuring what's at the end of the speaker cable. Then using simple math, I can tell the analyzer software to just subtract one from the other. So whatever shows up is basically the losses or distortions or the noise that gets added, or it's not subtracted, but if it were subtracted, anything that's different between these two will show up. So the effect is basically just the cable and nothing but the cable. I'm not measuring the amplifier, which has its own distortions and noise, and I'm not measuring the speaker itself, which has its own distortion and noise. I'm strictly measuring the cable in between. Now the conditions are the way the cable gets used. The load is on the right side. It's a real speaker. The load on the left is an amplifier. It's a switching amplifier, so it has high frequency harmonics and so forth. It's harsher, if you will, on a cable because it produces more than just the audible band. So I now ran a sweep. Instead of just one tone, it's 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. And this is what the difference looks like. Now, don't worry about the shape of this graph, in that the losses seem to increase as you go to higher frequencies. There are testing errors due to the cables I'm using and so forth. So all we care about in here is the difference between a generic cable and the expensive cable, higher end cable. And I've got both of those plotted, and you can barely see them separated here. And you might say, well, okay, so there is some difference in here. No, there isn't. If you look at the scale in here, that this is in decibel. The lower scale is 0.015 dB, minus 0.15, and the plus side is 0.06. So if you add up, figure this out, the entire scale from bottom to the top is 1/10 of a dB, not 1 dB, 0.1 dB. And within that, we have this tiny, tiny, tiny change. So it just gets lost on that. We can actually plot the difference between these two curves rather than looking at them as an absolute. And this is what the difference between the two cables are. And look at the number of zeros and decimal places in here. It's 0.0006 dB difference between the two. So it just is an absurdity on top of absurdity level of difference, but it shows you how accurate our instrumentation is. We're able to measure things as if, you know, I turn on the light and your light dims, you know, 1,000 miles away. We can measure almost effects that small with our instrumentation. But no matter what we do, we just can't tease out any difference between these cables. They're just made to pass through the signal, and you know, even though we can measure some tiny differences, your hearing is just so much worse than this that it's just not even in within the realm of possibility to believe that this cable makes a difference. So I'd say the conclusions are pretty strong in that, you know, we're measuring the cable, we're instrumenting it different ways, and in every way they're transparent, which is good news. So unlike some cables that go try to have active components in them or too much capacitance or inductance where they may cause issues, this cable at least is benign and doesn't do anything. But it also has no benefits. So if you're buying this cable and you already had a perfectly working zip cord that you were happy with, when I say zip cord, by the way, I mean the standard lamp cords or the, excuse me, garden variety cords. There's no reason to replace it with something like this. Unless you like the look of it, unless you like the feel of it, if the wires are exposed and you like to have this exposed and, you know, you have a nice looking system and this is like jewelry for your equipment, you're welcome to get it. I actually don't have anything against this company. As I mentioned, $150 to build you this is reasonable. It has good feel and qualities. I wish the company would just go through their website and erase everything to do with all these claims of fidelity and distortion, all that, and just say, look, the cables are cables, but we make them to length. We terminate them exactly what you want. We make them look nice. You can have bi-wire, single wire, any ending you want. And that makes tidy and pretty behind your equipment. The connectors are better quality, so they're not likely to pop out, come loose on their own. And I think you can still sell cables for $150, and there'll be a lot of takers, including a lot of people in our world. I don't have the need, but if I did, I wouldn't mind spending this kind of money. Now, if it were thousands of dollars, that would be a different ballgame. So, bottom line, feel free to buy the cable. I don't think they're ripping people off on this cable, at least at these prices. But certainly the marketing claims are wrong, and I wish they would stop just repeating what others do and promote stuff like this. Okay, thanks for watching, and see you in a future video. Bye-bye.